It's looking clear on the fairway. Will is looking to sink a pretty perfect game this round. He has his eyes on incident 13. He's looking a little shaky right now. He can't seem to get it exactly on what he wants to. Looks like he's ready to line up a putt.
Let's go!
And he's sunk the hole.
Well, welcome to Will Commentates Golf, but Mighty Switch Force. We're back with another episode of this, by the way. In the last episode, I was very flabbergasted with levels that were quickly becoming more challenging. And even now, I'm trying to remember exactly what this one is. I remember what this one is. This one's kind of interesting, I have to say. This one, you kind of like secure a bunch of things as you move down along here. But then there's like this big barrel puzzle you take that takes you all around the perimeter of this area. And yeah, I do remember this one. This one's kind of cool. This one's pretty neat. I also noticed that based on dislikes on the last video, people actually took my poll completely seriously. So I apologize for that. Don't worry. For the people that liked the video, thank you for liking the video, unless you actually did it for poll purposes, and you want me to let's play Inspector Gadget for SNES at some point. That won't be a thing anytime soon. But if that's the reason why there are likes on that video, then, I mean, by all means, I'll keep that in mind. And for all the people who disliked, thank you for believing in Mighty Switch Force. That's very cool of you. And for the none of you who favorited it, That obviously means that everyone was taking it seriously, or they might not have even took it seriously in the first place, and therefore they just didn't even favorite it anyway. You know, that was hilarious. I just kind of watched the interactions like just fly into the video after I did that. I felt kind of bad afterward because I was like, oh man, didn't expect people to actually like sincerely think it, but you know, I still had a fun time watching it happen. It ended up, as of recording this video, it's 7 likes and 3 dislikes. So, you know, if it weren't for the people who usually just like my videos because they enjoy my videos, you know, that probably would have been a pretty even game, which is interesting to think. Because it shows that not only you guys want to see me keep doing this game, but also that. But also that you would not object to seeing Inspector Gadget on SNES. Again, I have absolutely no idea what that is. Like, I've no idea. All I know is that it's a game that exists. And that's it. There we go. Jeez, this one's kind of tricky. It's kind of like a harder version of like the bomb level. Incident 9, was it? Kind of just a harder version of this one. Of that one. Of this one. Of that one. Of all of them. Ah, jeez, man. Oh, I'm doing horrible. Getting that top one's tricky. It's like a very... There we go. It's a very narrow window of time. Given. Alright, there's only... Oh, yeah, see? So this is the part where you have to do, like, big... This. Oh, no! Oh, I flubbed it up! I think they give you a checkpoint, like, right here, though, so... That's nice of them. Just in case you mess her up, you know? Woo! So cool. And you got some platforming to do, Ooh, man. Oh, boy. Okay. Ooh, that one's tough. Because you have to activate that one, like, right into your ascent. See that? Kind of really buys you a lot of extra airtime. It's, tricky, man. There we go. Want to make sure not to mess this one up. This always screws me over. There we go. I don't know. It's just tricky, man. I always, like, press the button, like, one too many times in there. And I screw myself. I still did not do great at all, as you can see. Wow. I'm gonna have a hard time blue-starring that one, but... You know, that's okay. That's the nature of the creation of this series, you know? Let's get to... Oh, whoops, I already did 13, man. Oh, no, I clicked retry. I apologize. There we go, quit. We're on to 14 now, yeah. There we go. Okay, let's see this. Oh, this one. Oh, friggin' good lord, man. Let's see here. Hmm. is very confusing. There we go. There. And then I just gotta do the opposite thing over on this side, right? Yeah, okay. There we go. Okay. This one is a very tricky puzzle. I'm not very good at this one. I know. A huge surprise. There we go. This one just... Wow. Okay, well, I really screwed it right there. This one just involves a lot of tricky switching and knowing how this all works. And I'm not a fan of it because of that. It's a bit tricky. Man, I didn't even have to do that. I already only have one health left. Great. Okay, well, I can't even go over there. I'm just gonna have to settle for going over here first. Okay. So over here. Okay, I shouldn't have shoved him over this way. I should have. There we go, okay. There we go, okay, good. This episode, I mentioned that I wanted to talk about other like console memories that I've had. Oh, this, I remember this. This part throws me off so badly. Oh boy, okay. There we go. Alright, I'm glad I didn't actually screw that up, so that's good. Let's see here. There we go. No, I can't do that though. There we go. There. Oh no! Will, what did you do, man? Luckily, the checkpoint's right here, so that's good. There we go. Then you can just do this, and then switch, and then switch, there. I feel in this level, it always kind of is an advantage to make sure that the colored ones are never, like, both, like, solid at the same time. Usually helps to cycle between the two if you can help it. Okay, I'm just gonna...
Okay.
Yeah, so anyway, sorry, I was gonna talk about other console memories. I've like sort of done something similar to this during Sonic the Hedgehog 3 because I talked about Sega consoles that I've played, but I've never really talked about PlayStation much on my channel. And honestly, like, and if I'm being like 100% honest here, it's honestly just because I never really played PlayStation all that much. Like, just 100% honest here. Oh, frig, man. Oh, I screwed it. So, like, I have played PlayStation, though. I've played actually a fair amount of it. It's just, a lot of it is, I don't really know how to say it. It's not unmemorable, because that sounds like I'm bashing the games, and I'm not bashing the games at all. They're great games. It's more just, like, I've never, like, sat down and, like, played them for days on end. Really the only time I've ever done that with a Sony console is with my PS2, which I think, you know, a lot of people could probably account for. Oh boy. Okay, there we go. Is that useful for anything? I don't think so. Okay, let's go on up here then. Look how long this one is taking me. These levels are going to take me forever to do for Blue Stars. That's why I'm only doing like 3 levels this episode. Okay, right, I can't kill him. Something I gotta do down here. But it all started with PlayStation, and I've played PlayStation, lots of PlayStation. My uncle had a PlayStation, and that's where I sort of played a lot of it. There we go. Oh boy. Jeez. Okay. What the No. There we go. That's what I wanted. There. Okay, so I got this all now. Perfect. Okay, so yeah, sorry. This is taking so much of my concentration. I'm sitting here wanting to do a discussion and I can't even do it. So for PlayStation, I played it a lot with my uncle at my uncle's house. And the main games that I played on PlayStation... a couple of my cousins had one too, that lived right across the road from me at one point. And, So the thing was, like, I never played a whole lot of it, but I've watched a lot of them. Because I was always watching, like, my relatives play their PlayStation. Oh god, this one. So, a lot of what I would play, or play myself, were the Spyro games. And I would, again, I'm not, like, an expert on any of these, like, Sony franchises, so I can't really say a whole lot about them. But from what I saw of the games, oh, frig, man, that's hard. That is really hard. I guess Spyro, I felt like Spyro was sort of like Sony's answer to like the Rare platformers. Because there are like a lot of collectibles to get and, oh boy. There we go. Okay, I get it. So, yeah, like, I figured that's sort of what Spyro was supposed to be. And, like, those games were fun. They were really charming, and there's, like, a lot of humor to them. I like collecting the eggs. I like the fact that there were, like, little mini-games you could play. In that sense, I feel like Spyro was still a little bit ahead of games like Banjo-Kazooie, because they sort of mastered the whole, like, let's have these worlds with really weird themes and put mini-games inside them, which Banjo never really did until Banjo-Tooie. So I felt Spyro was cool for that. Not necessarily better or worse than Banjo-Kazooie, I don't think. It was just a slightly different take on the same sort of formula. And, you know, both formulas have their place in games, and they're both cool in their own way. Another game I played, and I have to debunk this right now. I've never played Crash. I never played Crash Bandicoot. And from seeing gameplay of it, it doesn't look entirely appealing to me. It just looks kind of bare bones. It's like, I'm just gonna run down this straight path, and I can see everything ahead of me in this straight path, and there are things to do, but sometimes. Oh boy, why did I do that? but again, like, that's just from, like, seeing the game played, you know? And, I think Spyro kind of taught it to me, too, that, like, you know, just watching Spyro being played didn't really do the game justice. Because the game itself is kind of, like, just plain, you know? You kind of just gotta play it and understand that it's, like, you're on this big adventure and you're collecting things. Kind of like how just watching Banjo-Kazooie being played isn't, like, a 100% justice to the game. So, okay. There's three of them, and there's one more straight down from me. Where's that one? So, like, and other games that I've seen played on PlayStation were, like, you know, like, Tony Hawk and, Lego Racers, you know, a lot of those were just multi-plats, though. And I found most times I still liked them better on like, the competition on N64. And the only reason I did was because I felt like graphically... Oh, boy, what am I trying to do here? Graphically, like, the N64 wasn't really that far behind the PlayStation. In fact, in terms of actual, like, image clarity and cleanup, I would still say that the N64 looks better than the PlayStation. If not in raw graphics, and like I said, how it cleans up in terms of, like, when the video signal is fed through the wires on your TV screen and everything. I feel it looks just a little bit crisper on N64. But at the same time, and a lot of people say that this is a negative for the N64, and I boldly disagree with them. And I would fight to the bitter end to prove someone wrong with it. The fact that the cartridges were a bad decision on Nintendo's part. And commercially, absolutely. Commercially, the fact that Nintendo 64 wasn't, like, a disc-based system really hurt it, because it meant developers, like, you know, they didn't have as much space to work with. I keep going up here, and I don't want to go up here. I'm so dumb. Oh, I should have picked up that floppy. That little floppy dude right there. Okay, I need to go back across here. This is, like, the most confusing thing. This is so confusing. Oh, God, I did it wrong again. But... Yeah, so, like, with games like Lego Racers that I knew were on PlayStation and N64, I just felt they were better on on N64 because it was cartridge, right? Meaning that, like, the games couldn't hold as much, but it meant the multiplats all were, like, the same game, right? Like, otherwise it's not multiplat. But with that came the fact that, yes, maybe the PlayStation versions of the game were dumbed down due to being multiplats that also had to be on N64. Oh, I see. Yeah, the last girl's over here. Okay. But it also meant that... oh boy. Where the hell do I go now? I don't go this way. It also meant that, like, the N64 version, like, was just better in terms of visual cleanup, because they would be the same product, otherwise. But it also meant that the fact that they were on cartridge meant that the games didn't have to load. And I still stand by the fact that N64, I don't know, man. Just in terms of, like, consistency in the experience, I feel, like, sitting there with, like, a disc reading menu. I know, you guys are all freaking infuriated by this gameplay right now. I feel as though a disc reading message is, like, one of the most flow-breaking things, like, ever, and I absolutely hate it. When I have to sit there, like, and wait as the game stutters or just goes to a blank screen that says, like, loading, please wait, it bugs the shit out of me. I absolutely despise that about any game. And it... Oh, man. I can't even, like, describe it. You honestly have no idea how much it irritates me. And that's why I never liked the PlayStation that much. And with the PS2, it was, like, a little more forgivable, because I found there were more games that tried to find workarounds for load times, where they would have things like, you know, like dynamic memory, where they would be loading things in a little bit at a time, like chunking things in. Like the N64 worked. They tried to make it behave more like a cartridge, as the disc technology was more, like, better understood. Whereas on the PlayStation, they would load entire areas and make you sit there. Oh boy. Oh, this is the last level, dude. What? Oh. Check this out. I've never done this one before. I was gonna save this one, but I was like, yeah, you know what, screw it. Is this maybe, like, too climaxy? Should I not, like, do this? I don't know. I'm gonna do it anyway. This is a power of 5 minutes. Maybe I should wait. Okay. Yeah, you know what, maybe I'll wait. I'm sorry, guys. I'm sorry to be a freaking cock tease like this. I was gonna do the last one, but maybe I'll try to blue star the next three in the next episode, and then we'll do the last level and then blue star it in the last episode. But yeah, I'll just finish this up. I'll just sit here and talk. I know that there's no gameplay going on here, but I'll just finish up the discussion. Now I'm, like, fully focused on just talking, so. Yeah, so I'll close this up nice and quick with, like, the disc talk. That was just why I like cartridge systems better. But with the PS2, they made it better, and that's where I found that just, like, PlayStation games in general just got way better, was with the PS2. The PlayStation, and much like with the N64, they're trying to just, like, figure out how 3D worked and how they should make it work. Not even just from a gameplay or, like, actual, like, sitting down and playing the game perspective, just, like, technology, basically. They're trying to figure it all out, right? And with PS2, they definitely had a better, like, hold on how it worked. So you had games that felt like they flowed better, meaning that they had more time to just master the craft of 3D games. So you got, like, really great games like Shadows of the Colossus, like Sly Cooper games are, they look great, and from what I've seen in gameplay, they flow, and, like, it just, everything looks like it feels good to do. Kingdom Hearts, of course, I mean, as much as I really don't like that series, from a conceptual standpoint, the gameplay is fine. It's actually a very good action RPG. That controls great. What other games? I played Dark Cloud on PS2. That was another game that I remember my relatives playing a lot at their house. My cousin, sorry. That's a really cool game as well. It's kind of like a dungeon crawler RPG sort of thing. I have the game. I don't know how you guys would feel about, like, a partially blind playthrough of that at some point. I know that there aren't many, like, Dark Cloud fans out there. It's sort of like a cult, like, you know, small scale sort of thing. But it's highly beloved by those who really like it. I would recommend it. And, like, there are games like that, and those were all games that kind of showed where, like, you know, Sony and any developer developing on PS2 were like, okay, like, we've got a better hold on how this all works. So I remember that a lot. I remember one of my friends in grade 7 gave me his PS2 Slim, and then it, like, broke 2 months later. So, like, that kind of left, like, a little bit of a sour taste in my mouth for a couple years. And then when I saw, like, going into, like, the new gen, that PS2 was getting, like, these sort of, like, butchered, like, half-assed ports, I was like, ugh. I was like, because I was just kind of seeing it at, like, the back end of its lifespan. I was like, oh, man, PS2 sucks. But now that I actually own one myself and I've played a few games on it, there are a couple times where the ports for multiplats are a bit really shitty on it. But it was the first of, like, that gen of consoles besides the Dreamcast to come out. So it was probably to be expected that it was the least, like, advanced of that generation. But it also lasted the longest and sold the most. So it kind of goes to show that, you know, numbers are definitely not everything when it comes to this game. Game of competition. I don't have time to talk about Sega. But, maybe in the next episode I'll fill you guys in on Sega. Actually, you know what? I'll make this, like, my honorary piece. You know, I hope you all have a very good life. If you want to sit around just for another, like, 4 or 5 minutes and hear me talk about Sega, you can go right ahead. But if you guys really want to just, you know, go on to another video, there's the subscribe button. I'll see you guys in the next video. We're going to take on Incident 16. Peace. Jeez, I thought they'd never leave. Ugh, God. Good Lord. Ugh, God, yeah. Are they actually gone, though, viewer? Can you, like, look out the door? Good Pepsi. Thank you for looking out the door, by the way. I'm glad they're gone. So, yeah, so Sega. Sega was, like, sort of, like, the short, like, middleman runner in console history. Because they lasted longer than the other, like, wannabe console makers, you know, like Panasonic and, like, Philips, who else? Atari, you know, Atari in the 90s, at least, you know, Atari existed long before then. But, you know, Sega lasted, you know, like, from the late 80s to the late 90s, so, like, a good, you know, like, 10 to 12 years, I guess, if you take into account, like, you know, like, Japanese running times being a bit longer. They started with the Master System. Never even held or looked at a Master System before. I've seen the box of it, and at Most Wanted, the pawn shop on my island. I've seen a boxed Master System there, meaning I've only seen it in the box. I've still never even seen the physical product. Genesis, though, on the other hand, I've played a fair bit of through my years. You know, I kind of had the privilege of knowing Sega and Nintendo growing up, so it was kind of great. A lot of Sega and a lot of Nintendo. So I managed to play Genesis at, again, my uncle's house, the guy who owned the PlayStation. It seemed like everyone that owned a PlayStation later on had access to a Genesis beforehand. I don't know if this was some kind of, like, anti-Nintendo movement or something. Maybe. So I got to play it there, and it was really cool. If you guys never had the chance to play a Genesis, I would totally recommend picking up, like, a compilation disc or something. I know that there's a few of them, like, on Xbox 360, PS3, I know that. I'm not sure if they ever appeared on, like, PS2 or anything, but if they did, definitely go and pick one up. Because there's a lot of interesting ideas on Genesis, and Sega in general owns, like, some really awesome IPs, and they don't build on any of them nowadays, because all they trust is, like, Sonic and Hatsune Miku. Because Hatsune Miku actually sells well in Japan. But, you know, back when they were just experimenting and just, like, making all these interesting games and ideas, like, they developed, like, a lot of cool IPs that would be awesome to have seen expand. And, you know, if Sega was still making consoles to this day, we probably would have seen more entries in these, like, lesser-known IPs owned by Sega. Even nowadays, we don't really see as much Phantasy Star anymore, and that sucks, man, because Phantasy Star is so much fun. It is so much fun. Phantasy Star, particularly Phantasy Star Online, that was on Dreamcast, and GameCube as well, but more well-known on Dreamcast, was, like, Monster Hunter before Monster Hunter. Like, it was, like, the first awesome major console MMO, and it was, like, oh man, it was the shit. It was the coolest thing ever. Again, I've only ever seen it. The people who lived across the road from us, a few of the games they had, they didn't own Phantasy Star Online, but I think they rented it or something for a week or so, and oh, it was just so bomb watching them play it. It just, like, it felt like so much bigger than any game I've ever seen before at that point. It just, it felt like they were playing the future, and they were, because now that's all gaming is now. It's all, like, online or cloud-based multiplayer gaming. And Phantasy Star was, like, the first introspective look. Like, Sega knew what where the market was heading. It was incredible. And of course, other games like Sonic Adventure on Dreamcast, that was awesome. Crazy Taxi, fantastic. I never played Sonic Adventure 2 on Dreamcast. I thought that the actual sequel was Sonic Adventure 2 Battle. I thought the sequel went on GameCube, which really confused me. But no, there was a Sonic Adventure 2 on Dreamcast. I just never knew about it. Because my neighbors from across the road were moved out by the time that game even came out. They probably bought it. I just never knew. but again, if we're backtracking a bit, back to Genesis. Like games like Sonic the Hedgehog, played that at my uncle's house. He had Sonic the Hedgehog, but my cousins across the road, not my neighbors across the road, but my cousins across the road. I know this is getting very confusing. I leached off a lot of people for their games. They would always borrow a Sega Genesis from another friend down the road where we lived. And they had Sonic the Hedgehog 2 on that Genesis. So I got to play the first two Sonic the Hedgehog games on their native console, and I got to see them played. I wasn't very good at it. I was a much bigger fan of Mario at the time. But I grew up to sort of like them equally, because they're both just awesome, again, in their own way. And that's sort of what a lot of, you know, getting kind of a taste of all these different consoles throughout my life, that's kind of what they've taught me. It's like, they all feel like they kind of have the same branching concepts, and that's why people compare them a lot. But it's 9 times out of 10, the ones that are well-remembered are not better than one another. Like, Sonic isn't better than Mario. You know, Spyro isn't better than, like, the Rareware platformer. It's more like they're just, like, different kinds of great, you know? And it's kind of just up to you to determine if you have a preference over them or if they're just both awesome but in their own way, you know? And, you know, if we all had the money to do it, I'm sure we all would have owned all the consoles and it would have been hunky-dory and we all would have guzzled up great games and had a great old time doing it. But of course, money's tight. You gotta pick one of them. And when you pick one of them, you gotta stand by your choice because you want to feel justified. Oh, excuse me, as a consumer. So people get into big fights about which console is better and all that. And that's where it all stems from. But, you know, if people can take away that, you know, there are great games everywhere you look. You know, I made jokes in that Sonic fan character, or fan game video, that Sonic Adventure 3 was going to be on the Wonder Swan. You know, a lot of you probably don't even know what the Wonder Swan is, and I've seen a Wonder Swan before. It's not great, but, I mean, you know, I feel like there's probably, like, one or two hit games on the Wonder Swan, you know? I don't remember it, but apparently my cousins owned a TurboGrafx-16 at one point. I don't freaking remember that. I don't know if it was because they didn't play it a lot, or if I just didn't personally like a lot of the games on it, so I don't remember any of it. But apparently I've been exposed to that at some point, and I just never knew. Actually, I do feel like I remember seeing one of, like, the cards, right? Is that what the TurboGrafx-16 use? They have, like, these floppy little cards that have games on them. They just look like little playing cards with plastic bits. Anyway, I'm just rambling now. Another long episode of me rambling about consoles. Let me know in the comments if you guys have any memories of, like, consoles you didn't own, but you remember playing. It would be especially interesting if you guys can really dig deep into your memories and fill us all in the comments section about, like, a really obscure console that we might not even know about. The most obscure I can get is... What's the most obscure I could ever get? Probably an Atari, I guess? I think my... trying to think. This was up, like, Surrey way. Like, a couple of my, like, relatives, like, grandmother's generation, they had an Atari, and my dad always used to play Pac-Man on it, because he liked Pac-Man on Atari, but I can't remember if it was Atari 2600 Pac-Man or 5200 Pac-Man. the internet reaction to both would be, you know, like night and day. You know, Atari 2600 Pac-Man would be like, oh man, what a revolutionary game. Whereas 5200 Pac-Man would be like, I watched the AVGN video. The controller is ass. And again, I have no memories of actually playing it. I just remember seeing it played, and so I don't know if any of it's good or bad. That's about as deep as I can dig. In terms of an actual, like, physical memory, the most obscure I could probably think was... Probably Genesis. I can't really think back to anything that obscure. You know, I also know for a fact that the friend of my cousins that would give them the Sega Genesis also had a Sega Game Gear. But I don't remember anything about the Game Gear at all. I know that I remember it having like a full color screen, which was cool, and like backlit and everything. Again, just goes to show that, like, you know, Sega knew what they were doing. You know, they're always kind of thinking ahead with things, but the fact that they're always just so fickle with their console of choice at the time of marketing, you know, that's kind of what drove them down the shitter. But anyway, you guys don't want to hear me ramble anymore. Now we're going to end the episode here. This is like the real ending of the episode. So I'll just leave you guys off with this, and like I said, Incident 16 in the next episode, probably the finale. Peace! Thanks for hearing me out, by the way. Again, post in the comments if you, you have any console memories. Post any comments about how Inspector Gadget on SNES is your favorite game ever. What the hell?